Good afternoon, everybody. I'm hoping that that you can hear me. My name is Darren Montague, and I'm from Hays. I'm delighted to welcome you to the launch of our latest salary guide. I've worked for Hays for more years than I care to remember, and I am responsible for a collection of offices in the southeast of England. I'm joined today by Susanna Watson, who is the director for London at the CBI, and she's going to be looking at some of the policy issues that are facing the UK business community. This is the fourth year, actually, that we've produced our UK guide, covering over 9,000 salaries across 12 specialist areas throughout the UK. Now, it's based on the salary information provided by 1,900 of our recruiting experts from our 94 offices. Now, as well as using our guide as an insight to inform, we've also launched a survey designed to ascertain employee satisfaction, employers' concerns as well, and gather a more general view of what's going on in the market. And this has secured over 17,500 responses from both employers and employees. So it really does make it one of the most comprehensive surveys of its kind. It is rather the survey itself and the findings in the pack are extremely detailed and quite data heavy. I'm going to do my best to pull out some of the key themes, but really you've got to get yourself a copy of the guide and dive into the detail of what's most relevant to you and to your organization. So to start with, let's set the scene by quickly recapping what were last year's findings. So in 2016, that was prior to the EU referendum, 62% of organisations expected their business activity to increase, and 73% said that they were planning to recruit. And we were looking at a 1.8% average salary increase, and 62% of employees were considering moving jobs during that time. However, against the backdrop of continued economic and political uncertainty, and in the face of an increasingly tight labour market, we're here to look at how the employment market is faring right now today. So let's start with some positives. Employers are optimistic about the market and their business, which is good news. In the year following the EU referendum, there has been a slight increase in the number of employers predicting growth. It was 62% last year, 57% immediately following the referendum, and now it's back to 59% this year. Reassuringly, the vast majority continue to expect that their activity will either increase or at the very least stay the same. Before the referendum in 2016, 6% expected activity to decrease, and this rose to 7% immediately following the vote before dropping back to 5% in 2017. So as I say, that's really positive, really good news. And on the whole, organisations actually believe that their activity levels will either increase or at least stay the same, 94% pre-referendum, 93% post, and then 95% in 2017. So hardly any change overall, which is a really, really positive indicator about the overall health of the UK economy. Although there is obviously ongoing uncertainty, it does look like, with the findings of this report, that employers' business outlook remains robust and healthy. How the Southeast fits into this picture is outlined on this slide here, and as you can see, it's a similar percentage of employers expecting their activity to increase or at least stay the same as the overall UK average. And reflecting this continued business confidence, employers' plans for recruitment and investing in their people strategies have grown. We looked at organizations' plans to recruit over the coming 12 months, and again, positively, almost three quarters nationwide stated that they were planning to recruit people over the coming 12 months. This is higher than after the referendum and almost equal to the figure of 73% prior to the vote. So hiring clearly remains a top priority for employers who aren't reacting to the wider uncertainty by cutting their recruitment plans. Of those employers looking to hire, 59% state that they plan to hire permanent staff, and 29% plan to hire temporary, interim, or contract professionals. Now, despite this positive outlook and employers charging ahead with both business and hiring plans, they are faced with some huge recruitment challenges. In fact, we currently are operating in what we consider to be one of the toughest recruitment markets of recent years. Now, it's pretty obvious, but it's still a pertinent point. It's regarding skill shortages. Skill shortages are ever-present and intensifying, and as we'll see here, it's really impacting on more than just hiring plans. The majority of employers still don't believe that they have the talent that they need to achieve their current business objectives. It is also evident that these skill shortages are having a significant impact on organizations, and there's no reason why they won't continue to do so. 70% of employers stated that they have experienced moderate to extreme skill shortages, and of these, 15% labeled them as extreme. Only 6% of employers stated that they had not experienced any challenges with regards to attracting the skills that they wanted. In fact, 77% of all UK employers say that a shortage of suitable candidates is their number one recruitment challenge, and employers from across all specialist areas are being affected, as you can see from this slide here. Similar to last year, the majority of employers in the southern home counties also say that the shortage of suitable applicants is their top recruitment challenge for the coming year, with 81% saying this. The skill shortages are attributed to problems with both the attraction and the retention of talent. Over half of employers believe that high competition for talent within their sector or industry is fueling the shortages. This highlights the importance of investing in your employer brand in order to better compete for this talent. Employers need to make sure that they stand out with a distinct offering that will appeal specifically to the type of candidates that they require. Now, looking into the detail, we can see that leadership and managerial skills are most in demand by employers, followed by technical skill sets and projects and change management, as well as administrative experience. For those employers looking for skill sets that typically come with experience, looking to other approaches to hiring may be pertinent during these skill-short times. For example, hiring temporary contract or interim workers may hold the answer to filling some of these skill gaps in the shorter term or in order to meet peaks in demand. And greater investment and development in training is required in order to upskill more junior candidates or apprentices. Those approaches should be equally considered. We also asked what employers believe is most affected by these skill shortages. Unfortunately, such predominant skill gaps are already having far-reaching consequences and have the potential to severely restrict future plans, not just those relating to hiring. And particularly given the UK's poor productivity performance, which Susanna is going to talk about a little bit in her presentation as well, it is important to note that 59% of employers state that skill shortages are already impacting on productivity. 30% also state it has affected growth plans, 27% business development plans, and 25% have seen it directly impact on their revenues. Not only are productivity and growth plans being affected, but organizations are now realizing the full impact of these skill shortages on their employees and understanding that they put their staff under significant amounts of pressure in order to get the job done. Employers are faced with a double-edged sword, really, as not only our business objectives are being challenged, but employees are feeling the pressure. 41% recognize that employee morale is being negatively impacted by skill shortages, and 16% state that there has been an increase in absenteeism and, due to illness and stress. This correlates to the employee findings surrounding the work-life balance, whereby 44% of professionals nationwide rate their work-life balance as very poor to average. It's interesting that given over a quarter of employees value work-life balance most when considering a new role, addressing this could be a strong attraction tool for us as employers, yet only 15% of employers view it as important in order to attract staff. There are some additional mismatches which come out in the report in the benefits that employees deem important compared to the benefits employers offer, which further compounds the issue. For example, 64% of employees state that receiving over 25 days of annual leave is important to them, but only 45% of employers offer this benefit. Flexible working is rated as important for 61% of employees, yet only 50% of employers offer this. So in such skill-short times, progressive employers should consider and enact policies that are conducive to a greater work-life balance for their employees in order to be seen as an employer of choice, and therefore give you the ability to be able to attract some of the top talent that is still available. To address the immediate problem of skill shortages, 39% of employers are looking to temporary and contract staff. Furthermore, a quarter of employers are increasing their use of recruitment agencies, which is great news for me. 24% are recruiting apprentices, and a fifth are implementing mentoring programs in order to better attract candidates and upskill their current workforce. Back to the South Home Counties in the southeast of England, the use of temporary and contract staff to address skills shortages is on a par with the UK average overall. So, such mismatches in expectations of benefits are causing dissatisfaction amongst some workers. This is being exacerbated by a lack of salary increases, which is creating further discontent. The average salary increase in the UK has been 1.8% again, on a par with last year. However, this is well below inflation, and it's generally only jobs in areas that have got severe skill shortages that have seen any significant increases. For example, 13% of IT professionals and up to 10% with some of the construction and property professionals who have received pay rises of over 5% last year. Interesting slide here, looking at the picture regionally, salary increases were slightly above the overall UK average at 1.9% here in the southeast, and a range through to Northern Ireland at 2.8% and Scotland as well at 2.2%. Now, 57% of professionals say that they are dissatisfied with their salaries. Well, it's hardly surprising, is it? If you ask people if they want to be paid more money, they're more than likely to say yes, aren't they? So we do need to take those findings with a pinch of salt. But it's a slight increase from 55% last year. Of those who say they are considering leaving their current organisation over the next 12 months, 32% state that it is due to their salary. With fewer employees looking to move jobs this year, employers may yet again be forced to increase salaries further in order to attract the skilled candidates that they want. In our region, compared to the overall UK average of 32%, fewer employees cite salary and benefits as their main reason for wanting to leave their current role. However, it is still a significant percentage. Okay, so as I said, data-heavy, data-rich report, but that's been a whistle-stop tour of some of the key survey findings. I'm just going to take a few moments now before handing over to Susanna to summarise some of our recommendations. So first off, we have seen that despite the wider economic uncertainty caused by the UK's decision to leave the EU, employer confidence in activity for the year ahead remains positive. As a result of forecasted activity, recruitment remains a top priority for most organisations, with a particular focus on hiring permanent employees. However, acute skill shortages remain, and they look set to be the key challenge for employers. Not only may these affect recruitment plans, but they may also impact on productivity and staff morale. In order to meet business objectives and alleviate pressure on staff, many employers will hire temporary professionals instead. And in such a skill-short landscape, employers need to consider how best to attract and retain top talent And it is clear that in addition to salary and benefits packages, it's a positive work-life balance that is really important to the majority of candidates. Now let's look at what we recommend for employers during the year ahead. Firstly, we recommend that you make workforce planning a key strategic priority, if it isn't already. And despite the positive sentiment that we see from organisations with regards to their current activity and plans, employers are concerned about the impact that skill shortages are having on productivity and growth. Workforce planning needs to be a core component of every business strategy and at the top of the agenda. Understanding the range of workforce solutions available and considering the most appropriate options, factoring in elements beyond just immediate people needs is important, but also risk mitigation and cost management will help employers to put in place the most effective strategies for both the short, medium and longer term. And this will enable employers to mitigate the effects of the skill shortages while continuing to meet their activity targets. Secondly, invest in your employer brand to compete for talent. Ensuring that you have a strong employer brand has never been more essential given how prevalent the skill shortages are. And competition for candidates has intensified, and employers should target their offering to appeal to the specific type of candidates that they want to attract. Having a strong employee value proposition is central to this. Salary levels need to be benchmarked accurately, and our report can help you to do that, and they need to be positioned correctly relative to the market. And then progression opportunities and training and investment need to be well publicized. Employees want to be able to get an insight into what it's truly like to work at the organization so that they can assess whether they might be a strong fit with its culture. More employees are actively seeking this information, so employers need to ensure that they have a transparent message that is easily accessible both on and offline. Finally, utilize contingent workers for more than just projects. So employers' drive for growth is putting significant pressure on the workplace, which is in danger of fueling employee dissatisfaction and damaging morale. Given that skill shortages are so high, employers risk putting so much pressure on existing staff that absenteeism continues to increase and staff retention becomes an issue. Employers should consider their approach to hiring temporary workers, whereas traditionally temporary contract and interim workers have been used to supplement projects where specific skill sets are required or to meet peaks in demand, they could also be used to a greater extent to help alleviate some of the pressure from the increased workload. And this will help to ensure that growth plans can be sustained and targets continue to be met, whilst also improving on job satisfaction of permanent employees. So, on that note, I will now pass you over to Susanna, who hopefully is on the line. Susanna, can you hear me?
I can. Thank you, Darren. Thank you.
Brilliant. No problem. Over to you and your slides, and we'll come back to myself at the end for any questions. Off you go.
Brilliant. Thank you. And thank you for inviting me to speak today. We're delighted to support Hays. The CDI has supported the Hays Salary Guide for a number of years. It always throws out fantastic insights and a few surprises. So for those of you who are unaware of the CDI, we are the UK's largest business organisation. We speak for 190,000 businesses, small sizes, sectors and small regions across the UK. In terms of what we do, we provide a collective voice and influence government on the big topics that shape the UK business and economic landscape. So we represent our members' views and concerns for government. We operate in 12 regions across the UK and have 4 overseas offices. And today I've been asked to run through some of the sort of major issues really taxing companies at the moment. And I'll cover 3 main areas, focusing on the EU negotiations, international trade, and the government's domestic agenda. So, starting with the EU negotiations, as you've seen in the press, it is highly political, both in the UK and EU. Since the general election, we've been vocal in holding the government to account on key elements of the negotiations. This includes our call for a specific working group for business to feed into government, and we've succeeded in securing the EU Exit Business Advisory Group, which is jointly chaired by David Davis, Greg Clark, and Philip Hammond. The CBI sits on this group along with a number of other key business organisations. We've also seen positive movement from the government on the implementation of a status quo transitional deal, stay in the customs union and single market for a period of 2 years. However, the detail of this transitional deal is now absolutely essential before the end of 2017 to avoid businesses turning contingency planning into action. We've also been calling for clarity on EU system rights, and I'll talk a bit more about that in a moment. We also need to begin the trade negotiations as soon as possible. And, you know, just to give an example of what the CBI has been doing recently, last Monday we actually convened Business Europe and 10 heads of the European Sister Federations, along with the Prime Minister, Greg Clark, and David Davis at number 10. And in that meeting, they reiterated our key messages on the importance of positive progress in negotiations, the urgent need for agreement on a status quo transition, and beginning trade deal discussions as soon as possible. And that was from both a UK and EU perspective. Looking ahead, the December meeting of the European Council becomes absolutely central. The European Council President has said that once sufficient progress on the divorce arrangement has been made, then talks can begin on a transitional arrangement, and we are hoping that that will begin as soon as possible. Meanwhile, we've been communicating to UK government on the key impacts of a no-deal scenario, such as rising consumer costs, port and airport disruption and uncertainty around EU citizens' rights. All of these could cause the kind of economic cliffage that we're really looking to avoid. So there have been positive developments in recent weeks. The government is working to upskill departments and face key challenges head on, but the level of clarity on major issues is yet to be seen, and we're continuing to be vocal on these issues. On to international trade. There are opportunities for the UK to forge international trade policy post-Brexit. However, every major sector in the UK economy, for every sector in the UK economy, the EU is still the most important trading market. So in the short term, the focus must be on securing the best possible deal with Europe. The Department for International Trade, otherwise known as DIT, is now a year old, and it's committed to expanding its capacity and its capabilities. We've seen this through more active engagement with business, which is really positive, and an effort to quadruple their headcount. We've been working closely with Liam Fox and the wider team through the newly established Business Organisations Trade Group, which the CBI sits on, and it's fair to say that DIT has taken a number of positive steps to prepare for the technical planning which longer term bilateral trade negotiations will require. What we are saying is that these trade deals need to be ambitious, so they need to focus on goods and services which are cross-sectoral. They also need to focus on professional standards, IP protection, and digital gateways for sharing information. These deals are hugely time-consuming, but by cutting customs duties, opening up procurement contracts, and smoothing any regulatory hurdles, these could really facilitate growth and drive prosperity in the UK. Moving on to the UK domestic agenda, what makes business work, so focusing first on its people. The apprenticeship levy was implemented in April this year, which aims to increase access to and the quality of apprenticeships. Business is hugely supportive of apprenticeships, but the levies and flexibility is a real issue. The structure and implementation of the levy has always been flagged as a concern. It's important that the levy works for business. It needs to deliver long-lasting careers and help close the skills gap, and it shouldn't just be about creating a higher number of apprenticeships. Data published from the government in October actually saw the number of apprenticeship starts plunge 61% compared to last year, and because of this, we're calling for specific reform, particularly being vocal around the pooling of funds for local provision, making sure funds can work through supply chains, and making sure that the levy is more flexible in terms of the way that business can approach it. And I'd be really interested to hear how you found the levy so far, and if there's anything more that you think the CBI can help with you on that. On the continuing workforce, this is a major issue. There is now a sense that the EU negotiations are coming round on this issue. But in the meantime, the economy, you and your businesses are suffering through a lack of skills. The uncertainty around EU systems in the UK actually led the CBI and TUC to issue a joint statement calling on both sides to provide a clear guarantee of the right to remain for citizens in both the UK and EU27 as soon as possible. We've also recently submitted our response to the Migration Advisory Committee consultation on what the future migration system should look like. And this comes up with three key recommendations. First, around maintaining ease of access of doing business. For example, the ability to be able to travel between the UK and the EU easily. Second, accepting the need for non-graduate migration. This is vital for sectors such as healthcare, hospitality and construction, for example, but also business as a whole. And finally, providing frictionless movement for highly skilled migrants. And we at the CBI continue to call for more clarity on the proposed system as soon as possible. I'd like now to turn on to the UK's economic outlook in the coming months. So we are expecting softer momentum in the economy going forward, with growth expected to ease over the next couple of years. Our latest forecasts are 1.6% and 1.4% for 2017 and 2018, both of which are relatively underwhelming rates of growth for the UK economy. We expect to see less support from domestic demand, household spending and business investment. Inflation has been rising since the end of last year, mainly due to the fall in the pound, which has caused import costs to rise. We expect inflation to actually peak around 3% at the end of this year, and the rise in inflation is already having a stark impact on living standards, and we expect this to continue. So with, as Darren mentioned, with real wages falling behind inflation, this is causing household spending to slow, and I'll be interested to hear if the squeeze on consumers is affecting your operations. With CPI inflation running above the Bank of England's expectations, the Monetary Policy Committee decided to raise the bank rate in November for the first time in over a decade to 0.5%. But on a more positive note, net trade becomes a much more prominent driver of growth in 2018 as the fall in the pound actually feeds through to exports. And finally, the budget. So just wanted to mention the Chancellor's budget, which is actually being announced as I speak. So Brexit takes the headlines, but what we're saying is that it's absolutely vital that the government also focuses on the domestic agenda. Philip Hammond faces some difficult choices and widespread calls to focus on boosting productivity. He also faces a tough balancing act between the government's budget surplus targets and growing demand for more public spending. In our own budget submission that we released a few weeks ago, we've called for a series of key actions from industrial strategy and infrastructure to business rates and protecting per pupil funding. All of these are essential and would signal the government's focus on the domestic agenda as well as Brexit. That being said, it's important that the Chancellor also resources the departments to deal with the Brexit workload over the coming months and years. Also that it sets out a vision for tax policy that really helps the UK as an attractive place to do business. So that's it for me. That was a whistle-stop tour to some major topics, but hopefully that's provided some useful insights. And thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Susanna. That was great. Really interesting. Thank you for that. So that pretty much wraps us up. We are happy to field any questions that people may have. Now you can post your questions by writing them in the Q&A box, which is on your screen in front of you, or you can email me darren.montague. That's darren.montague. montague. At hayes.com, and then I can take your questions on email. I have got a couple of questions here already for you, Susanna, if you don't mind. One of the questions that we had earlier was, are we already seeing an impact on business investment as a result of the EU negotiations to date?
Yes, we are. We've definitely seen an initial impact on business investment since Brexit was announced. It actually deteriorated sharply after the referendum because of the heightened uncertainty at the time. It has actually improved substantially since then. But what we did is we actually released a survey a few weeks ago, actually, across our membership, which showed that 60% of businesses will be triggering their contingency plans by March 2018 if there's no transitional deal in place. But 10% of those firms have already put their contingency plans into action. So that could mean them moving staff out of the UK or slowing recruitment. So obviously that's a huge concern for us. It also resonates with what we're also hearing from members around a kind of a caution around some of the larger spending projects that they're thinking of investing in the UK. So that's why one of our key calls to the government is that we need to start the transitional arrangement agreement as soon as possible to really provide that certainty to business to stop that happening.
Okay, good. And then the other question that we've had through is in relation to productivity. Now, we hear a lot in the news about UK productivity and its continued decline. But what can the CBI offer to us as employers in terms of advice? I mean, what can we do to help contribute to solving the UK's productivity problem?
Yeah, so I mean, productivity is hugely important, and you know, in order to raise living standards, wage growth is something that we also mentioned, and also providing sustainable public services, we really need to solve the UK's productivity problem, and that means tackling some of the weak foundations of our economy. This ties into actually quite a lot of our recommendations to government around the budget. So kind of on a government-facing side, obviously communicating that clear plan on industrial strategy, so making sure that you know, we're really seeing industrial strategy as a solution to some of the challenges presented by Brexit, and we're expecting the white paper next week from government, and we will be working with businesses and so looking for input from you to help us feed into that. We are also calling to project per pupil funding in real terms. So research that we did last year was around regional productivity, and it actually shows that education was the key drivers of regional productivity across the UK. Another element of regional productivity was improved management practices, and actually flexible working came out as one of the kind of key drivers to help that in terms of improving regional productivity. So that's something really positive. And then also infrastructure products, so committing to those infrastructure products that are already underway and making sure that they're delivered on time. And also finally, just on the kind of investment in innovation and R&D in the UK. So we've been calling on government and business, so partnership combined, to agree to having 3% of GDP on R&D investments, a joint partnership between government and business. Government have agreed a 2.4% target of GDP by 2027 with a long-term goal of 3%. But what we'd really like is for businesses also to do the same. And we certainly have seen some recent evidence that businesses really are investing in R&D and you know, making sure that the UK is a great place to do business.
Okay, great. And now, Adam Bellamy wins the award for best concentration and was obviously very focused on the detail of the presentations because he has spotted the fact that the Hays figures show that most businesses are expecting an increase in growth this year, but the CBI figures are not on a par. So what's driving the difference? I think it's an interesting one, but I think from a Hays perspective, our survey is very much driven by how people feel, and I think people are pretty optimistic. Their gut instincts are that they will deal with any of the problems that are coming down the track, and we'll make the best of it, and are feeling positive about their ability to be able to control their own destiny and grow their businesses. And I think the CBI information, whilst it is based on members' views, it is also very data-driven, isn't it, Susanna, in terms of the data points that you're feeding into your numbers in order to form your view?
Yes, absolutely. So we use a lot of government figures, but we also use, we have a number of member surveys that we go out to, both by sector but also by issue, and that feeds into our analysis as well. So direct input from the businesses that we work with. And in terms of growth, one of the key drivers of growth will be the net trade, particularly in 2018, as the fall in the pound starts feeding through into exports.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, I hope that answers your question, Adam, but if you want to continue that debate, then feel free to email me. Lisa Briggs has just commented on a really insightful presentation, so thank you for the compliments, Lisa, and feels that it is reiterated that we need to focus on our employer brand and the work-life balance benefits. So yeah, absolutely. One of the things that I would add to that I didn't really cover in my presentation was that I think a lot of employers would say that they have an employee brand and attraction strategy, but there is sometimes a disconnect between how the most senior people in an organization perceive that and how it's actually then being translated on the ground, particularly by the line managers that are doing the actual recruiting. And I think it's really, really important that we've got, that we're joined up and so we've got some consistency of message from the top of the organization right the way through, because ultimately it's the line managers that are sitting in front of the candidates, and it's important that they can actually articulate that brand and those attraction techniques in order to get people on board. And too often they're relying on the fact that they assume that the candidate sitting in front of them would naturally want to work for them, and that's not often the case. It's really have to work hard in order to sell your organisation to attract people on board. Pam Whittington has asked whether we can share the slides. The presentation and the recording of the WebEx is available on our website, so you can visit that hayes.co.uk/salary guide. So punch that into Google and you should find it pretty easily. Okay. Right, that's pretty much bringing us up to time. So I'm just checking my emails to make sure there's no more questions and there aren't. So as I say, if anybody does have a burning question that they'd like to ask, but they didn't have the confidence to write it on the chat box, then feel free to email me, darren.montague@hayes.com, and I can come back to you one-on-one. And then make sure that you contact your local Hayes consultant and arrange a meeting to get your copy of the salary guide, and they will be delighted to come out and deliver one to you. Thanks again to Susanna for her contribution. I hope you found it useful. It was only 45 minutes of your time, and I think it could really add some value to your organisation as you plan for the 3 to 6 months ahead and the challenges that we face. But without further ado, I will call that time. Thank you very much for dialing in.